Hello and welcome to a new era of the AST podcast. It seems like we're always doing new eras, but this is another new era because we have a new title.
Marketing and Communications Coordinator.
Marketing and Communications Coordinator. Ali Crawley, who is with us at AST and who is coming on board on the podcast. And so every second week, we're going to have a new format where our guest will be joined by both Ali and I to ask questions. And so this is going to be a sort of a new and exciting venture in the podcast. We decided to start this new year with just an Ali-only podcast. And we're going to speak about an area that that is central to Ali's role here at AST, which is social media. Mm-hmm. And so we're going to be speaking about the difference that the social media world, again, when I was Ali's age, there was not such a thing as social media. And I think it means, I don't know exactly how it means this, but I think it means that that was a different world, that people related differently, that people understood the world differently. It's a very, very significant shift. For someone who's never lived in a pre-social media world, what do you think of whether it does make a difference, and what kind of difference does it make?
I think social media has two major differences. I think it made us a lot more connected to the world than what's going on around us, whether it's true or not. And it also harmed us in a way of, for example, people my age would rather text someone than have a face-to-face conversation or a phone call. So even though we're connected and we're communicating more, we're not having as organic interactions, if that makes sense.
Right. I can relate to that.
Yeah.
Because I prefer text than, than in person. But I always thought that that was a kind of a, you know, an actual deficiency in me, that it was a kind of sort of like a, and I think it probably is, that sort of that there's some form of social anxiety there. And so do you think that it's a more natural form of communication, or do you think the social media world, as you've suggested there, means that people are less comfortable in interpersonal?
I think people are less comfortable with face-to-face interactions because of social media.
And it's right across the board. That's true of your friends, or is it is that an Ali?
It really depends, I feel like, on your personality, but I would say generally my friends, whether it's them going for an interview, they start a new job, applying for school, anything like that, they would rather just it be online or through text. Which is sad in a way.
Well, maybe. I certainly understand that, particularly a lot of people of my age and older do find that really scary and weird. You also mentioned that people are more connected and to the world, and so the world has shrunk. And so when you get your up to speed on what's happening in the world, what are the forms through which you do that?
Mainly on Twitter and Instagram, I would say. Facebook sometimes, but that's more of interacting with those like immediately around me, my friends and family. But if I'm keeping up with, you know, the celebrity news or just news in general, I would go on Twitter and then Instagram.
And are you happy with that? Because I'm the same in that Twitter is my first port of call. And usually after 10, 15 minutes on Twitter, I'm angry, depressed.
No, it makes you feel some type of way, that's for sure. Or just kind of makes you think, what is the world coming to?
Right.
Like, do we really live in this world?
So is that the stuff that the people say on Twitter, particularly behind anonymous Twitter accounts, do you think that that's their real selves? And if they were in person, they wouldn't be saying that? Or is that an artificial self that they've created?
I would say, to me, it would be artificial because I feel like just knowing people personally, how they represent themselves on Twitter or on Instagram couldn't be further from what they live day to day.
And so do you mean like in terms of like a sort of nasty stuff they say?
Or even just the lifestyles they portray. I feel like, especially on Instagram, because it's all photos, you only see the good parts of people's lives. So you feel like you have to live up to this expectation. Always going on trips or eating certain meals, but when you, well, for example, I have friends that I definitely know do that, because when you hang out with them, they went on that trip that they're still posting 2 years ago. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
And they eat smoothies and kale salads every day. They're eating pizza, just like everyone else.
That is, I think, troubling. I've read some studies which have a sort of, so let's start with, and then we'll come to some other things I find troubling about it. But one of the troubling things is that rates of anxiety and depression among university age women in particular is just gone through the roof. Like apparently someone was more than 50%. Again, I don't know if this study, what it was, a small sample size, more than 50% of women in university are being treated for anxiety and depression.
Oh, I believe
and
that.
So that's another chunk in addition to that, that are probably suffering. And one of the reasons for that they were suggesting was that every day they are mocked and haunted by their social media selves. Mm-hmm. And so what you were saying there about Instagram, that here we have the, you know, let's say here is Kate, and then there is Kate who only eats smoothies, who lives off smoothies, and who is constantly on, you know, social justice trips, surrounded by starving children that they're feeding, and only is ever captured in the best possible light.
Yeah.
You know? And so every day, Kate wakes up and says, I'm not that person.
Yeah.
And all these likes are for that person, not for me.
Exactly.
And her own self-worth is going down and down and down because of that gap. Is that something that you could, that you relate to, or that you think is the case?
Oh, 100%. Like, I'm never putting pictures up of upset and crying, you know? It's always smiling, happy, fun things. It's not the stressed out stuff. And it's not even saying I, like, have that much stress, but everyone deals with some sort of anxiety, but you would never let that known on social media.
Yeah. And so much of our celebrities or our stars, what they sell is that artificially created thing. So you create a sort of a Kardashian brand or whatever, and then people buy that brand.
100%.
And they want that lifestyle.
Yeah.
And that's the thing that I'm, and again, here a sort of my old foginess is going to be at its most extreme, but how do you feel about that as someone who is a product of a different generation, that is sort of, that there's an artificial world which is based on so much commercialism and, you know, luxury and this thing, and that's packaged, and then everybody says, I just want to wear those clothes, I want to have that lifestyle, I want to sign for that, and it's just all appearance, it's just capitalism times 20. Is that something that you are uncomfortable with, or is it something that you okay with, or how do you feel about that?
A part of me is okay with it, just because that's all I've really ever known. It was always to keep up with the Joneses. You have to have XYZ. And then a part of me is sad, because it makes you think that the friendships you're creating with other people are only because you fit in with their clique or what you're wearing. They can relate to that, not your personality. Yeah.
How do I? Okay, so I've got my eldest daughter, who is 12, just turned 12, who's one of the Lauren Dor, but she's also brand conscious.
Yeah.
And she also wants certain kinds of shoes and certain kinds of brands. And to me, as someone who spent most of his life as a socialist anarchist, that hurts my heart. So some advice. How do I, so let's say if you were if you were that 12-year-old.
I think I was that 12-year-old.
so what should I do and what shouldn't I do? Because obviously I shouldn't give her Karl Marx and say read that. Like,
it's hard to answer that question, because I feel like I was that kid.
Okay.
And mom, but I feel like my mom still can be that way. Like, she buys certain brands.
Yeah.
Say if there's a purse and it's a brand that she wants and it looks identical to something that's much cheaper but not a well-known brand, she's going to go for the more expensive one. Yeah. And that was like me. I always had Nike shoes. I don't know what it was. Loved Nike.
Yeah.
Still to this day.
Oh, yeah.
I wear Nike, but when I'm in the gym, they hurt my feet. Why am I doing it? So I guess my advice would be, say if she wanted Nike shoes, she gets Nike shoes, but then she has to ask, does that make you feel different? Are you performing better? Are you running faster than your friends? Probably not.
Right. But you're 100% right. And mm-hmm. Sort of the Blundstones and Nikes are the only things that go on her feet. Like her feet would just dissolve in anything else. And so there's a Christian theologian called Augustine, who was just manic in terms of his guilt, mm-hmm. right? And so he would often feel that, you know, when he was singing, so he'd sing the Psalms, right? Yeah. And he was aware, when I'm singing the Psalms, am I trying to give glory to God? Or am I trying to elevate myself over others and say, listen to me, I am the bomb at singing. And he felt that most of the problems in the world were caused by the way we try and assert ourselves over others. Mm-hmm. You know, like any species, any animal species tries to assert itself over others. And humans do that in very subtle ways. Mm-hmm. And there's a sense in which, in wanting to wear these things that are expensive, mm-hmm. she's trying to assert herself over other more economically disadvantaged kids, mm-hmm. and say, look at me, love me, because I can afford this stuff.
Yeah.
And so there's a real morality issue there, mm-hmm. which is problematic. But that's the world, in a sense, she lives in, because everyone is looking to particular stars mm-hmm. who are showing these brands, and they want to be like that. And so it's like a quest for power.
Yeah.
You know, it's a quest mm-hmm. to have a sort of, you know, social capital, you know? And the violence there, mm-hmm. you know? So, like, is there anything I can do to try and help her see that she is wonderful just because of her,
exactly.
not because of the stuff that goes on her feet or how she looks in a particular life when she takes a particular selfie, but is she just that she is just loved and valuable in herself,
right.
And that you know her goal should not be to assert herself over others, because these other people who may not eat smoothies every day and who may not live in these countries, that they have just as much dignity. Like, how does one with a child, like, how do you start to, or do you just say, come back to me when you're 18, you're a kid, go for it, have fun, knock yourself out, what's the best thing to do?
Well, when I was younger, it's hard because I feel like I relate to your daughter a lot, but I'm trying to make a conscious effort to
to
know when I'm trying to one-up someone, essentially, is what it is, because it's not nice and nobody wants to hear it. One thing my dad always told me was, like, treat the CEO with the same respect as a janitor.
Right.
So, I mean, at the time, it didn't mean anything to me. But now, looking back, I'm so happy he would tell me that. Right. Or he'd say, I don't care what you want to be in life. If you want to be, like, a garbage man, do it. But just be the best you can do.
Yeah.
So he never, I wouldn't say he ever had these crazy expectations. He wanted me to be successful and happy. But he always told me he wanted me to be happy first.
Right.
Right. I guess that helped me a lot.
Gotcha. That is helpful. Mm-hmm. I didn't intend for this to be a sort of a, you know, learn from Ali but another thing which is a little troubling is, so the self is being shaped by the person. So mm-hmm. again, in this imaginary person is being shaped by this Instagram world and presenting this thing and this image. And so it's not that she is necessarily expressing herself in the social media world. The social media world is shaping who and what she is.
Yeah.
Now, one of the areas where that could be troubling, or maybe it's not troubling. So let me wind it back and say some positive stuff. So there are an awful lot of, you know, traditionally persecuted minorities, you think of LGBT youth and people like that, for whom the social media space and online interactions allows an exploration of helpful, which is really, really positive.
Right.
Okay. But this culture of online relationships, I'm thinking here about Tinder, Grindr, thinking about the absolute ubiquity of nude selfies and things like this,
right.
That this seems to me to be establishing norms which are forcing young people, particularly mm-hmm. young women, mm-hmm. To be a certain kind of thing.
Mm-hmm.
So the reason why we want to wear Blundstones or whatever is to be loved.
Yeah.
You know, it's to be liked in art. What if in order to be loved or liked, you have to send new pictures, you have to present yourself in a certain way to a male audience.
Mm-hmm.
So is there a sense in which, again, the social media world is shaping people, again, particularly these young women who we said are suffering anxiety, depression, and unprecedented mm-hmm. rates? Is that a problem? And tell us about why you think that's a problem or isn't a problem.
I do think it's a problem. I'm pretty young and I kind of grew up in that world. You're supposed to look a certain way because of what social media has told you, which is definitely troubling because I feel like I can speak for myself and a lot of my other girlfriends. You don't know if someone actually likes you for you. So you have this sense of insecurity, whether maybe you met a guy on Tinder and you were a completely different person, but you guys start dating. I feel like the whole time you're going to say, does he like me for me? Or is mm-hmm. it because what I was saying him kind of thing, which is awful because that's where I think the self-doubt and the anxiety and depression come in.
Yeah. We have this idea. And again, it could be, it's right in many ways.
Yeah.
This is a sort of a golden age of feminism, mm-hmm. right? And that women's rights are much more prominent today than they were in the past. That's true 90% of the ways. I'm thinking, though, about, again, the bad old days, 1890s, right? And if you're thinking about dating rituals, mm-hmm. and how males would often, and again, class plays in here and a whole host of other things, so this is not across the board, but dating rituals would have involved men auditioning at length
mm-hmm.
To try and gain a chaperone date mm-hmm. with the woman and so on and so forth. I know that today, one young woman I know, my mind exploded recently, where she was just chatting away and, how was your weekend? Oh, it was good. Yeah. She sort of met a guy on Tinder at like 7 or 8 o'clock in the evening and then went to his apartment like around 11. Let's see.
It's scary to think about. It's middle of the night. Not safe.
You know, like a pizza.
Yeah.
You
know? It's like mind-boggling.
Like, now again, I'm sure this is a patriarchal prejudice, but to me, that seems a more male-shaped model of dating.
100%. I can't speak for everyone, but I feel like a lot of females feel like they're the ones, they have to impress the guy.
Yeah.
And if a guy doesn't like them, there's something wrong with them.
Yeah.
It's sad that people are more scared to get in a cab alone than show up someone's house they just met on Tinder. Yeah. Like, that mind boggles me.
Yeah. It does seem strange. So one of the things which, again, this is another study that I saw, but it was charting a development in heterosexual dating practices.
Right.
And it was charting it against two other models.
Mm-hmm.
And one of the models was the dating practices and the culture within gay male sexual culture. And then the other one was in gay female sexual culture.
Mm-hmm.
And one of the interview questions was, you know, were you with your partner now 5 years ago? And apparently within gay female culture, like, 90% said yes.
Right.
Within gay male culture, it was like 5%.
Yeah.
Like that said yes. And long before there was a Tinder, there was a Grindr.
Yeah, you know? Yeah.
And And so you have heterosexual relationships starting to look far more like gay male sexual culture than gay female sexual culture, which seems to indicate that it's male sexuality which is the driving force.
Yeah.
And so how can this be a positive development within a feminist society when it's becoming more male dominated than ever before? This is bizarre that I'm sort of saying, Ali, solve this for me.
I wish I could solve it, but I really don't feel I have the answer.
Like, what can we do about this? How can we as a culture push back against these forces? Because these forces are just driving. And again, like the kind of thing your dad said in relation to, you know, the CEO and the janitor. I'm sure parents can say similar things to try and help particularly young women have a sense of self-worth and self-dignity that no asshole online can take away.
For sure.
But it's a tricky. Now, this is typical, you know, old man shakes fist at cloud kind of, you know, but you have flagged the fact, and this is your business, that there are opportunities to make contact and to share information and share ideas in social media. And so that's one of the things you're doing here at AST, that you're looking to use social media to bring the cloistered ivory tower of the university out and to give people access to it.
Exactly. We kind of just want to put the word out there. So follow us on Facebook.
So tell us about the different formats. Are there particular formats that are more suited? You flagged earlier on the idea that Twitter is good for news and information.
Yeah.
How do the various social platforms stack up as vehicles for getting ideas out there?
To me, Facebook's, if you want to share like community events or community works that you're doing or your organization or just like of your normal life, Facebook seems the most organic to me, as weird as that sounds. It was the first social media platform I was a part of, but it's always been the most organic. Twitter, like to get news and events, updates of what's going on. And then Instagram is just a world of photos that you aspire to be.
Right.
To me.
Which, of course, is crucial for branding.
Oh, of course.
We want to somehow
highlight the best, show the best.
We want to misrepresent ourselves in a really positive way.
Not AST, but maybe me.
I think we do too. And so do AST have an Instagram page?
We don't have an Instagram page.
Okay.
The reason is just because our demographic isn't typically online on Instagram.
Yeah.
So it's something I'm looking into, but I'm sure we're going to make a LinkedIn page because we don't have a LinkedIn page for the school right now.
And how do you understand that relationship between working with our market, the people who are interested in the stuff we do, and branching out beyond that? Instagram is an example. Again, I've only asked you almost impossible questions. Here's another one. Is there anything a theological school can do to interest people outside its traditional audience?
I know we spoke about it before, but I feel like we do have our traditional audience, and I feel like there's an untapped market that maybe we know exists, but not everyone knows exists.
Right.
For example, I really like to watch prison shows, and there was a chaplain who was going back to prison because he wanted to try and make it better and debunk, I guess, what people typically think. He was trying to help the inmate out, and to me, that was a huge market. I would never think that a previous inmate would turn to a chaplain. Like there's I don't know how to say this. So many people who are not directly involved with churches have an interest for it.
Of course.
They're looking for some, it's just like social media. We're looking to aspire to be something greater. We all want to be something greater. And I'm sure a ton of people believe in something greater, but they just don't know how to express that.
Gotcha.
If that makes any sense.
No, it makes perfect sense. So there's a huge amount of people out there who are thinking about, for whom, when they think about reality or the world, they're not thinking just about material things, that there could be God, a life force, you hear reference to the time to the universe. Yeah. As if the universe...
Good vibes only. I see that all over my Instagram feed.
Exactly.
Positive vibes only, good vibes only.
Yeah.
But they don't even know what they're believing in.
Yeah. And so there's more than likely a sort of a group of people out there who are interested in these things and might like to think about them and talk about them and explore them further. And I suppose on TV, we have lots of ways of exploring these kinds of things. Like, again, thinking here about the supernatural, that this sort of, you know, you see the popularity. I remember that there was a scene in Game of Thrones, right? Mm-hmm. And so in the first season of Game of Thrones, everything was a kind of fairly normal, it was fairly plausible. And then all of a sudden it was that scene when Daenerys walked out of the fire with the dragons. Shit, this isn't just normal stuff happening.
Right.
And it was like a real moment of a kind of delight, you know? And so people are looking for something more and open to the idea of something more. And is there a way, you think, because you mentioned that our audience aren't on Instagram, maybe there's a way through Instagram that it could generate interest. And again, not necessarily that people would say, I'm going to come and read Thomas Aquinas or David Dean.
Yeah.
But simply, here's people who are exploring outside the traditional box's ideas.
Right.
Maybe that's something I might like to look into.
Yeah, and I think Instagram would be potential to tap a different market, like mm-hmm. we spoke about, of people who are interested in it, but they don't know what they're looking for. It's almost mm-hmm. like we have to solve a need for them.
Yeah, yeah. And you think about we mentioned the Kardashians earlier, but all the stars,
right,
are in various ways, in different ways, religious. Like, there's none of them that aren't.
The amount of times you see Oscar speeches, anything, I just want to thank God for this opportunity. Mm-hmm. They have tattoo crosses.
Yeah.
They have Bible quotes on them.
Yeah.
But for some reason, people still don't see that as normal, if it makes sense, which is very odd to me.
Yeah, like, and the Kardashians in particular, like a sort of, and Kanye, like these are people of faith. Again, Kanye's faith is mainly in himself, but they do believe in something more. And really scary mother.
Chris. Oh, I hate
like
that I know this.
She's full on, like a sort of, like religious.
Obviously I watch the Kardashians, and if they were like swearing on something or they were telling the truth, they would say Bible.
That
was their go-to line, and they would always say Bible. Yeah. But people don't relate the two.
Yeah.
Like, I heard my friend start saying Bible, and I was like, what? Yeah. Where did that one come from? Yeah. Okay, you're telling me the truth. It was just like a little quirky saying. But people will not put it back with religion or theology or anything like that.
Yeah. Yeah, and I think, like, obviously Taylor Swift, Katy Perry, yada, yada, mm-hmm. they all have... a sort of some religious angle. I know that Ariana Grande is Kabbalah.
Not a big Ariana Grande fan.
But it's interesting that that people will look up to such stars and want to wear the shoes, want mm-hmm. to all that sort of stuff, but are kind of weirded out, but seem to just miss.
It's unfamiliar for them, and if something's unfamiliar, it's scary, and you want to put yourself out there, because what if somehow you don't get it, you fail? Like, I think fear of failure or not knowing is what scares people the most.
Right. And so when you were coming out as someone working at a theological school, was that difficult, or what did people say?
Oh, every one of my friends was like, you? Like, it's promoting a product. It's marketing. Right. You know what I mean?
Yeah,
but they were like, you? Isn't that weird? And I said, I don't know. And then I came here, and it's definitely a different culture than what I'm used to, but I love it. I have fun doing what I do every day.
Right.
And I think I said this to you before. I wish my friends could just come spend a day here so they would see how not weird it is, how normal it is.
Yeah. And maybe that's one of the roles or one of the things that something like Instagram can do
showcase.
A kind of to showcase I was going to say normalize, showcase
stuff. But we have our community lunches, they're so fun, and really delicious food, and it's just getting together with friends It's no different than me going out on a Friday night for food with my friends. Do you know what I mean? It's similar, but people just can't catch on to the concept.
Right.
Or my friends, anyways.
Right. And your friends will probably get broadly representative, would they? I don't know. Of cultural norms.
I would say so.
And so in this podcast, so Ali's going to be coming in every second week.
Mm-hmm.
And what are the kinds of topics? So one of the things I've been doing and that I've been really enjoying have been a sort of very in-house topics. And
right.
So myself and, someone that I like and mm-hmm. sort of, we'll talk about things that are really inside baseball.
Right.
But every second week, we're going to try and talk about something. So, for example, one episode we could have done this week would have been the Oscars. Like, what
right.
are the ethical, moral, religious angles
right.
on Oscar winners? You know, because, again, most of the movies looked at really significant culturally hot button topics,
right?
Like the fallout to the movie that won Best Picture.
Did
you watch the Oscars? I didn't watch Oscars.
Oh, I think it was though, because I was going to watch that the other night.
right. And apparently, it's a great movie, but it also is very, very traditional in the way it's a kind of a white guy who will kind of is the protector and the savior of the black guy.
Right.
And Spike Lee was going, this is just BS, you know?
Yeah.
And so there's interesting conversations to be had there about a sort of whether, Hollywood that pretends to be woke is actually as quote-unquote woke as it was.
No, so I agree.
So every second week, one of the things I think we'll have to do is to look at the broader topics with Ali, which I think will be a lot of fun. And I'm looking forward to that. And viewers, listeners, if you can think of topics, by mm-hmm. all means, send them to like me or to Ali.
Yep.
And maybe we'll get those on the road. So it's fantastic to have you with us at AST, and to be flying the flag in this social media space. Or is that phone? I should have. So just pretend there's no ring there. And so thank you very much for coming on, and we look forward to having you in 2 weeks' time, where we'll be looking at an exciting and interesting topic.
Mm-hmm.
And thanks so much.
Thank you.
Cheers.